few years back, local brewer, Bell's Brewery, released a series of beers. It's based on a musical composition by Gustav Holtz. My rules for this: first, I crack open the beer. Second rule, I start the song. And then I start the movie while I drink the rest of the beer. Hello, I am back after watching Total Recall and enjoying the first beer in the Planet series, Mars. I am back with the second beer in the series as Venus, bringer of peace, as opposed to Mars, the bringer of war in the first one. This one's a little bit less. It's 7.5%, and it is in the style of a malt beverage brewed with apricot juice and honey. I remember this one being a bit sweeter, a bit more fruity. I remember enjoying this one. I think Bell's had this one on the menu a couple times too after the release, but I'm not sure how often they actually did more of that one. It was not bad. Again, I unfortunately have no way to test this before I opened it, so I don't know how well it has aged. Hopefully it will be just fine like the Mars one was, but we'll see in a minute. The movie that the Alamo Drafthouse paired with Venus was Little Shop of Horrors. And this one I am going to stick to what they used because, frankly, it's a great movie. 1986, so mid-80s. The effects are brilliant. Audrey, throughout the whole movie, is a puppet. Audrey 2, I should say. Audrey's the actress. Audrey 2, the plant, is a puppet throughout the whole movie and is amazingly well done. Still holds up to this day. This is one of those movies I really never want to see them remake because it's only going to be lesser in quality. I do, however, want to see the stage show. I've never actually seen the stage show, and I've heard amazing things. I know the ending is quite a bit different than what's in the movie. There are copies of the DVD that have the original ending. I don't think this is one of them now that I'm thinking about it, but I have seen the original ending online. You can Google it. It's on YouTube, usually. It's not very good quality because they didn't do a lot of the finishing work with it. Spoiler alert, in that version of the ending, the plants win. It's a very downer, dark ending. The whole movie is great. So we're gonna start just like the last beer. I'm gonna go ahead and crack it open here. Still smells really good, so I'm assuming it's gonna be taste just fine like the last one. Let's start the song so I can get to drinking. Yeah, it's still good. It's a lot sweeter than Mars. My friend Chris on the live stream just suggested that I pour the beers so we can see what they look like. I'm gonna go get a glass. I have my Alamo Drafthouse Lost Weekend 10 pint glass here. I figured that was a good one since I'm following a Alamo Drafthouse model here for the videos. And let's go ahead and... It's a nice amber color. I don't know how well that comes across on camera. I like it. You can really taste the fruitiness in it. It's a little sour, but I feel like I remember it being sour the first time. It actually kind of matches the color of the planet on the bottle. I don't think all of them do that, but this one, they did a good job with that. So yeah, that was nice. Again, the movie we're pairing with Venus is Little Shop of Horrors. I think the whole idea is that it's a Venus flytrap or some brand thereof. Let's go ahead and start the film. This is a Frank Oz picture, I believe. Frank Oz is the voice of Miss Piggy and Fozzie Bear. He has also directed several movies, most of which are good. Most. Turn the volume up a little bit for this opening number. I mean, it's a musical, so having the volume down is kind of stupid. I'll worry about YouTube with that later. So this is actually a remake of a movie that was made in like the 60s. I know Jack Nicholson has like a brief cameo. If you've ever watched this one, you know the part Bill Murray plays. He basically plays that part in the original. After this movie came out, they start promoting that one heavily with starring Jack Nicholson, even though he's like in it for like 5 minutes tops. I have seen that version. It's not bad. It's pretty good. It's not a musical like this one. I think that movie came out, and then they did the stage musical based on that, and then they did this movie based on the stage musical. Rick Moranis. The ever-great Rick Moranis. I understand why he left acting, and I totally respect it. For those who may not know, his wife died, and he had children, and he decided to leave acting to raise his children. Acting can be, especially movie acting, you may have to travel for a movie, you may have to be on set away from, or not on set, but near set away from home for a long time. So he decided to stop doing that, to be home to raise his kids. And I get that, I respect it, but every time I go back and watch a Rick Moranis movie, I just wonder at the career that could have been, the great films we never got because of that. He is great in everything he was in. I know there are people who don't like musicals. I don't generally get that. There are musicals that I don't like, sure, but in general, I don't mind musicals. They can be fun. It's a lot of social commentary in this one. The Skid Row song. Do they say whether this is New York or Chicago in the movie? I forget. I would assume New York, though they don't really give any specifics. So I was just thinking, it's kind of too bad that the musical isn't later in the series, because a few more drinks and you might see me singing along. You're not gonna see that right now. I can tell you that right this minute. You're not gonna, no. One of the things with it being a Frank Oz movie is that obviously his connections to the Henson Company, he was able to get a lot of really talented people to do the puppeteering of Audrey too. Most of them were Henson puppeteers, I believe. All right, again, somebody in the chat is saying that IMDb does say it's New York, which is interesting because they don't really give a lot of, In my opinion, I could be wrong, but they don't really give a lot of, I'm afraid it isn't feeling very, like, there's no big shot of the New York skyline, which you would expect in a movie that has, like, plastering the New York skyline all over those movies to make sure you know it's set in New York. Funko Pop makes a figure of the Audrey 2 in the coffee can. That is one that I would really like to get if I ever come across it. I do like how when they're not singing, the three girls, the chorus of the feature, they're always there in the background somewhere, just kind of watching the action. I love to miss the Mushnick, but I have a date. Oh, John Candy scene. John Candy as the radio host, another great actor that you have to wonder what the career trajectory would have been. In his case, unfortunately, he died, so it's not quite the same as Rick Moranis. But again, a lot of great films, and you just wonder where it would have gone. So in this shot, the plant, he's got the plant on his lap, and he's holding it. I'm kind of wondering if they have him doing the puppeteering. He's sitting in the waiting room in the radio station. The lady's bent over in front of him, and the plant is trying to take a bite out of her butt. I'm wondering if, like, one of the arms is a fake arm, and it's actually him doing the puppeteering for it. Or I guess he could have it positioned just right so somebody else has their arm up between his legs, but that seems like it might be awkward. I guess. I know he grabs it in a second here. Let's see what hand he grabs it with. Yeah, so he's holding it, like, with this arm, and he's got this arm free, and he, like, grabs it. So I'm wondering if this arm is fake, because he's holding it, like, here. And I'm wondering if this arm is fake, and he's got his actual hand up in the puppet like this, because then he grabs it with this hand. That's how I would probably do it, but I don't have the resources or money of a professional film, so... Though sometimes the easiest things are the best way to get away with things. So. Oh, you got me! So I'm almost done with this beer. Just got a little bit left to go. Movie's still going. Oh, nice little animation sequence there with the bird. I forgot all about that. Great song here, Steve Martin. You don't even question the black hair. It's amazing. That could look really bad, because even by this point, he had white hair, so. I've never had an issue with Dennis. It probably helps. I've never had an issue with needles or anything like that, so... I don't know, maybe that's the issue. I've had teeth pulled. Actually, kind of a funny story with that. I had some wisdom teeth pulled, and I wanted to be knocked out. I didn't want to be late for it. The surgeon talked me into just using a local numbing, because he said, if we have to put you out, we have to put you out, wait till you're down, do the surgery, bring you back up. You could be here for a couple hours. If we just use a local, we can wait till you're numb, pull the teeth, you walk out of here, you're in and out in like 10 minutes. I was like, okay, fine, if that works, fine. So they did it, and they pulled the teeth. I had all four pulled at the same time. They pulled the teeth, and they were like, okay, we're gonna let you sit here for a minute. We'll check in on you in a minute to make sure everything's clotting right and you're not bleeding out or whatever. And they're like, okay, just stay here in the chair, and they leave the room. A few minutes later, I hear from very far away, outside of the room, I just hear, Neil, Neil, you need to wake up. Neil, it's time to wake up. And I'm sitting there wide awake, freaking out. Eventually, they came in, they pulled the gauze out, checked me out, put more gauze in, and then said, okay, you're good to go. I walk out into the lobby, and there's this other kid there with presumably his parents, and he looks groggy. And I look at him, I look at the parents, and through the gauze, I guess I was somewhat audible through everything, but I'm like, please tell me his name is also Neil. And they're like, yeah. I'm like, oh, thank God. Because it was freaking me out just hearing from far away, Neil, Neil, you need to wake up. That was probably one of the most surreal experiences. Surgery went fine. I didn't have any complications, no issues. I didn't even really end up taking any of my pain meds. So again, I never had any issues with dentists other than scaring me emotionally and mentally, but not physically. So what do you call that thing? Now it's gotten fairly big. Presumably at this point he's still only feeding it blood from his fingertips. It's gotten quite large. I think tonight, I think this scene is the first time it talks to him, and it basically convinces him to kill the dentist and feed him to him. I mean, it's literally, it looks like it's about as tall as he is in the pot. Yeah, it's there. It's actually a little bit taller than him. I don't think Rick Moranis is especially tall, but man, yeah, Yeah, those mouth movements when it talks. It's just amazing.
Feed me, Crabhorn! Feed me now!
I can't.
I'm assuming some sort of cable and rod. I think someone also would have to be physically in there to kind of move it. Maybe I'm wrong. I do know one person on my Facebook friends list who could possibly answer those questions, but I don't know if they'll be watching this and I'm no longer live. I know a lot of the vines, I guess they would be. He's a plant. Cable and rod. Really does feel like at this point, the plant does have agency. I mean, with how much it's moving around, and it does feel like it literally grabs Seymour and pulls it closer to him at one point. And it does feel like if it wanted to, it could ditch Seymour, but eat him and then like just eat whatever else comes in. I don't know. I guess maybe having Seymour as kind of a scapegoat as far as numbers go makes some sense. Ah, the Bill Murray scene. Just the look on his face. I don't totally understand Bill Murray's motivation in this. Like, the whole thing seems to be that he wants a candy bar for free because he heard somebody got a candy bar for free after their dental visit. But, I mean, candy bars aren't expensive, so there is kind of maybe a sadomasochist thing going on. Because, I mean, he flat out says, like, I think I need a root canal. When he obviously is not in any pain or anything at all.
I went to a terrible dentist on Wednesday who was recommended to me by somebody that I saw on Monday, who's the brother of a man that I usually see on Sundays. And their mother actually taught them everything that they know. She's incredibly gifted and quite elderly, and a lot of people think she shouldn't be working. But I go to her because I'm just incredibly devoted to her strength. She can't really see who you are, but she knows the sound of your voice.
He's been to several dentists this week alone.
Only I got out of here okay, and then you know, after it was all finished.
Yes, I got a candy bar.
I
thought I'd get a candy bar.
You go through a little thing and you get chocolate out of it. We're getting to work with incredible professionals. These incredibly, incredibly wonderful equipment.
Say,
I'm not even sure that's a real tennis tool.
A little giggle gas before I begin increases my pleasure enormously.
Oh, Jesus! I'm in trouble now, huh? When will I turn this gas off? Uh-oh. Oh, give me a hand, would you?
So I guess they kind of redeem Seymour's character in that he doesn't actually, at least in this part, kill anybody. I don't think he does end up killing anybody. He does chop him up and feed him to the plant, obviously, but it's not through his actions that the guy is dead. I don't know. It seems like a murky area to me. I don't know about you. What do you think? Seymour killing? My cat's over here staring at me. I'm sure if she could speak, she'd be saying, feed me, too.
It's not true.
You don't know the half of it. I've led a terrible life. I deserved a creep like Orin Scribello, D-E-T-S. You know where I met him?
You know, I don't think I could have told you his name.
In the gutter.
I know he's the dentist. I know they refer to him as doctor. I don't think I could have told you his name until that scene just now. Like, on this watch, even now. Oren? His name's Oren?
Nice ones like this. Low and...
Man, things gotten huge just from meeting one person. And that's, again, if you ever go and watch the original ending on YouTube or somewhere online, they get huge. I think there's a shot of one eating up like a subway train, like a, or not subway, I guess, but a train, like a spaghetti noodle. Like, this is a really interesting, I like the way the scene's shot. when they're going up the stairs. It's true.
Come on, your future with Audrey. Come on, come on.
It feels very surreal. It feels like these stairs, and granted they're going slowly up the stairs, but it feels like the stairs are almost elongated and like a lot higher than they are or would be to me anyway. Every time I watch it, it feels like it takes them a really long time to get up what is essentially just one flight of stairs, but it feels like it goes on for a long time. And then the singer is coming out at the darkness of the alley across the street.
What do I have to do?
Just feed. Kind of wonder if there was a specific up and downside to Audrey, or if it could, Audrey 2, or if it could basically flip however they needed it to.
Yes.
I mean, there's nothing specific about it, but I wonder if the way it was built, like with the little tongue inside of it, if it had to be one way or another, or the way the lips closed too. Man.
Oh my god.
Tomorrow. It's kind of interesting seeing her, the change in her wardrobe after the doctor is out of the picture, the dentist is out of the picture.
Tomorrow we could leave here together.
And not together. She's with Seymour. Man. It's kind of almost totally different wardrobe.
Well, what do you mean?
Marry me, Audrey.
It's much more light and.
Will ya?
More feminine, I guess.
Married right
I don't know, because, well, before she was wearing very tight, dark colors, animal print, and now it's like it's a very pink with the white lace. She's kind of an interesting change in the character from one part of the movie to another.
Feed me.
Under no circumstances.
Feed me.
I will not, so stop asking.
There's just, there's so much movement in the lips. And it's not just up in the, it's like,
cut the crap. Bring on the meat.
Fluid. It's, I, you wonder how they did it. Because it is all practical. It's a puppet. Like today, they would probably do, even if they did some of it practically, they would probably do the mouth totally CG on a large puppet. Kind of like what they did with Where the Wild Things Are, where it was a, it was, the monsters were people in suits, but then the faces were somewhat computer-generated, computer-animated. This is one of those movies I kind of never want to see them remake. No matter how good the effects are, no matter who they cast, it's just, this is the definitive version. I never really got the impression that Audrey 2 was actually hungry at the point where he was telling Seymour to feed him, especially not with Mr. Mishnick. He had just eaten the dentist. And Mr. Mishnick was kind of more of a meal of opportunity. I've never really gotten the impression that Audrey 2 had to eat necessarily at the moments where he was asking Seymour to feed him. He had to eat to grow, but he wasn't like hungry. He didn't have like hunger pains like a human. Audrey 2 has to know that eating her would upset Seymour and possibly end their partnership. Though granted, maybe at this point, Audrey 2 is autonomous. Audrey 2 doesn't feel it needs Seymour anymore because if it's gonna eat the woman that he loves, obviously there's gonna be repercussions from that. It's either really hungry and not thinking straight or it no longer feels it needs Seymour. Possibly both. I don't know, that's my opinion. So we have seen Audrey 2 welt and kind of shed leaves earlier in the movie. And obviously part of its plan is to spread, but you would have to think that taking cuttings of it would hurt it. Maybe not. I don't know. Again, I'm applying human standards to a plant. I guess it depends on what they need to snip to get it, but I'm kind of surprised nobody's tried to, like, steal a part of it. Granted, that's not part of the story. I know it's a movie, but seems like somebody would have tried to steal a clipping of the plant if they thought they could just take a clipping and grow a new one. So in the original ending, Audrey 2 actually dies, not Audrey 2, Audrey actually dies of injuries she got when Audrey 2 tried to eat her. He comes in and he pulls her out and they go outside, but then she's been bitten and she ends up dying. Rick Moranis actually ends up getting eaten as well. Basically cuts to a final song by the three ladies singing Don't Feed the Plants about how basically shortly thereafter somebody did come and take clippings of Audrey 2 and grew versions of the plant and sold them. They grow and they eat. That's what they do. So then, because this is an alternate ending, I'm wondering if they had to rebuild the set, if they still had it, if they added that scene early. I think Someplace That's Green is part of the musical, so... Because Don't Feed the Plants is usually... The original ending is usually what's done in the musical, not the happy ending. So, that was beer number two and Little Shop of Horrors. I'm going to take a quick break, do a couple things, and then come back with the third beer in the series, which is Mercury. And we'll see what that movie is.